if we forgive others. Unforgiveness is a major blockage to our own forgiveness and our own healing. God wants to forgive us and heal us, but sometimes we have that barrier there, that barrier of unforgiveness. And as it says, as we forgive others, we don't get to pick and choose who those others may be. It's all inclusive. Anybody and everybody that has ever offended us or hurt us in any way needs to be forgiven. It may be physical abuse. It could be a one-time slap in the face or punch in the nose, or it may have been ongoing, oftentimes beatings endured as a child from an out-of-control parent. You need to forgive. It could be verbal abuse, being cursed at or being degraded, told you were stupid or useless or wouldn't amount to anything. You may even been told by a parent that they wish you had never been born. Still, you need to forgive. It could be sexual abuse, anything from unwanted sexual advances from a boss to fondling to rape, whether it was a one-time situation or repeated, whether it was a family member, an acquaintance, or a stranger. You need to forgive. It could be a robber violating your home, stealing not only your material possessions, but also your peace of mind. Or it could be a drunk driver that severely injured or even killed a loved one. Still, forgiveness is necessary. Now those examples are all the big time kind of examples. Things that most likely have caused trauma. And those things need to be dealt with, but that's another whole teaching. But it doesn't have to be a big thing. It could be a small infraction. Somebody says something that rubs you the wrong way. Somebody embarrasses you. You were counting on somebody to come through for you, and they let you down. It is amazing, in a negative way, how we human beings can hurt each other so often in such a wide variety of ways because of sin. But in any case, no matter, you need to forgive. And here's the point. When you choose not to forgive, and it's always a choice, forgiveness is always a choice, it's most likely that forgiveness will not stay as unforgiveness. It starts as unforgiveness, and I'm using this picture here as a tree. It starts up here above ground. But the longer you stay in unforgiveness, it grows, kind of festers like an untreated boil, and it gets bigger and bigger and deeper, and it goes underground, so to speak, in your soul. It gets entrenched, and you can see all the horrific, tangled roots that it becomes. And in the healing ministry, the language is often, it's often called a root of bitterness, because bitterness gets in, and it seeps deep into your soul, and it can affect, and does affect, most every part of your life. It shades everything dark, and it's much harder to deal with. It's much easier to get rid of the unforgiveness when it's still up here, before it develops those deep roots under the surface. It's much harder to dislodge it when it happens down there. You may have heard it said that holding a grudge is like taking a bottle of poison, just drinking it down, and expecting the other person to keel over. Well, that's not going to happen. Oftentimes, the person you offended at doesn't even know it. And if he or she does know it, they may most likely don't care. If you can have the offending person's participation in the act of forgiveness, that would be wonderful. But it is not necessary. The person may not be available emotionally to you. They may not be at that place in their own spiritual journey that they can receive what you have to say. Or that person may not be available physically. They may live far away. The person may be incarcerated in prison. Or the person may have even died. But you can still forgive them through prayer. Here's a different scenario. Perhaps you are the offender. Perhaps you're the perpetrator. You caused the offense to someone else. It works the same way. In that case, if It's up to you to go seek out that person or persons that you have hurt and ask them to forgive you, no matter what the time lapse is. If that person isn't available face to face, you can choose any form of communication that makes you comfortable. Phone, text, snail mail, email, whatever. If they choose not to forgive you, that's on them. That's between them, that person, and God, and you will deal with them. But you are released. You did your part. You went and asked for their forgiveness. Not only is forgiveness good for your spiritual self, it's also good for your mind. It gives you peace of mind. And it's also good for your body. The medical field here in the United States is finally discovering more and more the connection between our emotions and our illnesses. 75 to 90% of our doctor visits are now being attributed to our ill emotions. And fear and anxiety and anger and unforgiveness lead the pack. Some cases of rheumatoid arthritis, some cancers, and some heart disease are all now being attributed to stress, which is often caused by anger and unforgiveness. And nearly 50% of us lie awake at night due to stress, again, which can oftentimes be attributed to unforgiveness. Another aspect of unforgiveness is that you may not need to forgive another person or be forgiven by somebody else. It may be yourself. You need to forgive yourself. Oftentimes, we're harder on our own selves than other persons are, and certainly harder on ourselves than God is. Realize God is not harsh. He is not hard. He may and will convict us about our sins, but he never, ever condemns us. And if you are operating, or someone you know is operating, under a spirit of condemnation, realize that is a lie from Satan. It is not God. Or you may be angry at God. Now, most of us don't ever want to admit that, not even to our own selves. So oftentimes we turn that anger inward into ourselves, or we turn it outward to someone else or something else. So I'm going to share with you now my own personal testimony about anger towards God. I was mad at him for a brief few moments when my husband passed away, and that was just over 2.5 years ago. It was to be expected. He had been gravely ill with congestive heart failure, and he was on a serious decline for the last 2 years of his life. We were in doctor offices, labs, hospitals, ER rooms, and rehabs more than we were home. In fact, we were there so often, we joked with the hospital staff sometimes that they should devote a wing to us, have a plaque. We were there more than we were at home at that time. But we were still both believing for heart healing here in the now. Even when the medical profession threw up its hands when several major interventions failed, we still kept believing for an awesome healing miracle of God. And some people maybe thought we were in denial, but it wasn't that. We kept receiving small miracles along the way to keep us encouraged. So we were still believing for that really big one. I went to wake up my husband, Ken, again, some of you know him, to get ready for church one Sunday morning, and he did not wake up. If I had been alone in the house, I probably would have started prayers for raising the dead. I was that convinced that it was not his time to go yet. So for those few moments, I was beginning to get mad at God. But then clearly in my spirit, I knew he was saying to me, "Oh no, don't go there. You need me now more than ever." So thankfully, I quickly turned away from anger. I obeyed him and rebuked him and used it. So be reminded, what you hold on to is actually holding on to you. Whether it's anger and unforgiveness, or whether it's peace and forgiveness. So at this point, you may be thinking, "Linda, that all sounds good in theory, but you don't know my situation. I can't forgive or possibly be forgiven." You'd be correct. I don't know your individual personal situations. You would also be correct in that you can forgive, not in your own power, in your own strength. However, the Lord knows what you're going through, and he's standing right there next to you, ready and willing to jump right in with his power and his strength to forgive or be forgiven. When you're ready, you ask him in all sincerity, if it's needed, to help you, and he will. He will always be happy to help you forgive someone or be forgiven. Now, forgiveness may be an instantaneous release, feeling lighter. It may even come with some physical healing. But most likely, it takes time. Usually, emotional or inner healing comes in stages. It's often referred to as an onion, and you're peeling the layers off. They need to be removed, slowly peeled off, one layer at a time. So, just keep going back to the throne room. Keep going back to God in prayer as needed. And you will, eventually, look like this. I would like to close, since it is Lenten season, I have a little devotional called Do You Want to Fast This Lent? And it's attributed to the words of Pope Francis, but I found it on Reverend Nigel Mumford's website, By His Wounds. Reverend Mumford is an awesome man of God, and he's been used by God to bring lots of healing in many lives from post-traumatic stress. He himself dealt with it for years. He had been in actually the British Army and had seen a lot of warfare, a lot of bad things, and he was severely traumatized by it. And through the years, God helped him to deal with it, and now he has a wonderful, thriving ministry called By His Wounds that deals specifically with post-traumatic stress. So these are the words. Fast. Fast from hurting words and say kind words. Fast from sadness and be filled with gratitude. Fast from anger and be filled with patience. Fast from pessimism and be filled with hope. Fast from worries and have trust in God. Fast from complaints and contemplate simplicity. Fast from pressures and be prayerful. Fast from bitterness and fill your hearts with joy. Fast from selfishness and be compassionate to others. Fast from grudges and be reconciled. Fast from words and be silent so you can listen.